Thank you very much for this very kind invitation and introduction. And it's a pleasure to me to be here once again. Thank you, Carlos. Thank you, Jefferson, for this opportunity. And today that will be divided in two lectures. One will be today that it will be devoted for the core losses region. I will show you the outline of the lecture. And tomorrow will be a little bit more in the low loss region. And we will also see several combinations of TM techniques or not TM techniques, techniques that they can develop also in the TM. So yes, I am coming from this place, from Zaragoza, here in the map. You can see it's in the middle between Madrid and Barcelona. And there we have this advanced microscopy laboratory that now is a national facility for Spain. And there we have several branches. We have three. And one of those is TM, devoted to TM, where we have these four microscopes, TM microscopes, and these two that they are aberration corrected. Most of the works that I will present you today are related with this one. Most of the works, no. Part of them, the new ones, because before I was in another place, and I will present you works coming from another older microscope. But this one is an aberration, probe aberration corrected microscope with a monochromator and with all the capabilities for analytical studies. It's similar to this one that you will have here in few months. And the other one is the complementary to this one, that is also an aberration corrected microscope, but is more devoted for high resolution or for Lorentz and holography and another kind of studies. In this one, we can also run tomography. And I will present you tomorrow some of the works that we can do combining ILS and tomography. And that is more or less all that I wanted to discuss you or to present you my place. Let's go to the lecture. As I told you, there are two. So the first one will be until more or less this part. I will present you the instrument, the principle and the generalities of the technique. I will describe you all the works that you can do with core losses, so absorption etches, with the quantification, the identification, and also going behind that, further studies in illness, in the fine structure near of the edge. And tomorrow we will deal, as I mentioned before, to the low losses and the combination of different techniques. So today, okay, today we will see all these parts, and the first part that we need to go is the principle, what is ILS with this electron energy loss spectroscopy technique. So we have here this cartoon where we have our electron beam that is going through the condensers and so on, and we have our materials, and there are a lot of interactions, Coulombic interactions, between these electrons with the electrons and the atoms of your material. And after you have several possibilities of different excitations and different processes that are taking place. And already I know that you saw something similar. Here I am describing all the potential phenomena that they are achieving, they are producing when we have this incident electron and it's coming or is going through your sample. Today we will be interested in this inelastic part. We have the elastic and the inelastic one, so it means that the electrons are transferring energy to the sample or not. In this kind of inelastic one that we have here a cartoon, I don't know why it's doing that. The cable, do you think? Okay, so we have here this cartoon, the elastic one that you saw before this morning. You see a little bit of diffraction and imaging and so on. And today we will focus more in the inelastic one, we see here these two possibilities, that one electron is going through your atom and is is interacting with these electrons in the orbitals of the atom, and they will suffer this loss of energy, and we will detect this loss of energy, and can be in the inner or the outer orbitals or states, and there we have different transitions that they are taking place. So I will also describe a little bit, but later you have a whole lecture about the X-rays, because it's another analytical technique that is more or less complementary, or even complementary. Tomorrow I will show you some examples of the complementarity of the two sample, or the two techniques with the yields. Here you see this in this table, the kind of things that we can do in yields and EDS or other analytical technique in the TM. And if we compare them, we can see here a lot of things about the depth of the sample that we can prove. The resolution that we can get now is much better than that. Now we have atomic resolution in both cases, but it's an old one. And more or less the information, and that is the important point, the accuracy or the detection limit of the techniques. Let's say it's much better always in yields, even it depends of the kind of material. So that is a whole yields spectrum of a boronitride nanotube, and we see the two or three regions that now is, the two or three regions that that we can see in the spectrum. We have these core losses, that is the main topic of today, where we have the absorption edges. And we have the other one, the low loss. The low loss is the region where we have the interactions that they are concerning the plasmons, the interband transition, intraband transitions, measurements of the gaps, and so on. And we have another one that is not a real region because it belongs to the low loss, that is the zero loss. That we can say that these are the electrons that they are not interacting with your sample. Okay? So, yes. I think it's something with happening with the detector. Probably it's in an automatic way or something. Yeah. But it seems like it's checking something. It's checking the source or. Okay, doesn't matter. We continue. So I told you that these are the transitions that we are proving in yields. We have this, in this sketch, more or less what is happening. We have always the transitions to the unoccupied states. So it's an spectroscopy that is dealing with the unoccupied states, looking what is happening there. And we have these core losses. Here we have two examples, boron nitride with boron and nitrogen KHs. So we are proving the transitions from the 1s state to the vacuum, to the conduction band, to the unoccupied states. We have the manganese that we are proving there, the L23 edge. So we are dealing with the transition from the 2p core states to the vacuum again. And we have the low losses, the plasmons and the interband transitions, where we have the transitions between the valence states and the conduction band, these ones here. And tomorrow we will describe all the things that they are happening in this region. That is a little bit of theory, and I can switch on and restart. Why saying that is as the M? will be faster in this one, I think. Okay. But I don't have. But I have, yes. In this one, I don't know. We can continue. Do you think that is? What is the automatic 45 seconds? What is that, the meaning of that? I think it's related with the automatic 45 seconds, that is. Manual. Yes. Should be okay now. Okay.
I hope so.
Sorry. So we are in the words of the slide. But I don't believe that it's related with the computer, eh? Yes. Yes. So let me check. And now, if you are doing shorts, something like
the second one.
No. The first one. Yes, it's a VGA.
No, needs to be working this one, but doesn't work. He's doing here, this the resolution is higher, so he's trying to adjust the resolution.
But I have an HDMI.
I have a switch for.
Okay, so in this case.
Why are you trying this way?
Okay, I am continuing this way and.
Sorry for that.
Let's continue. Let's try to finish this one. That is. Okay, so that is the only theory part that I am showing today. This one and a little bit more. The rest will be not so hard, I believe. So that is the what are we measuring in EELS, the kind of magnitude that we are measuring in EELS. So because it's the EELS magnitude or the EELS measurements is related with this double differential cross-section. That is telling us what are the probabilities of the transitions between the different states and giving us the more or less the what is happening during this this process. So we have three terms, or two terms in reality, because this one is the radar for an electron, a free electron radar for term, and we have the other two, this one that is related with we are based in the Betted theory, and it's related with the probability of this transition, so the Fermi goal route that we are following there, and this one that is related with the conservation of energy. Okay, if we consider this term here, that this the dynamical form factor or in elastic one, is, as I mentioned before, is proving the probability of the transitions between the final and initial states, and can be seen like a generalized oscillator strength that we have in optics also. And in this case, is this Gauss is the depending of the overlap of the symmetry of the the overlap of the spatial overlap of the wave functions and the symmetry of this wave function. Sorry, now it's my fault. Okay, so we have this this expression here. That is a nightmare. And we will see that, okay, can be expressed in this way. As we are under this dipolar approximation, that we know that for the electrons that we are working on, we can have this this approximation there. And considering that the this momentum transfer is below of one radian and so on, we have this Taylor series that can be considered, and stopping only in this term here. And in this case, we have this expression that can be wrote in this way. We continue the more or less the approximations, and we know that always theta, this scatter angle that we will see later, is always below pi radians, and the energy, the loss energy, is below, always below of the energy of the electrons, the kinematical energy of these electrons. We are dealing with something that is several tens or 100 or 200 kilo electron volts, and there we are measuring losses that they are few hundreds of electrons or only few kilo electron volts. So we can express, we can have this expression where we have these two terms, one that is related with the kinematical factor, that is related with the incident electron, and the second one that is related with the atom here. Okay, so that is more or less the part, the theoretical part that I wanted to show you to see what is behind the technique, because we will see that this expression could be after some other approximations to see what is related with the local density of states and why we are seeing these finite structures and the near of the edge and so on. So that is also related with the nomenclature that we are using and that you will see also in EDS, that is quantum mechanics, no? The kind of transitions that we are involving in this in each of these processes. And we see here the most important point, apart of this nomenclature and what are the edges that they are involved, is the shape of these edges. We have here these sawtooth edges, that they are the K edges, the L, M, and N edges, and you see that in these cases, in L and M, we can have these white lines that they are very characteristic, like, for instance, in the copper or iron, you can really recognize this kind of edges. So it's something that also is, it could be very useful when you are doing the experiment and to you have more or less, usually you know your sample, but no, it's not always the case. No? If you don't know the sample and you are doing this kind of analysis, probably if you see one of the edges, more or less you know the energy of this edge, you can distinguish what are the element that is behind that because you see the shape. Okay. Now, as I mentioned at the beginning, we are doing an analytical technique, TM technique, but it's not, this one is not the only one that we can run in a TM. There is also EDS, and it's interesting to compare the, both of these techniques. We know that the process is completely different. I mentioned before how it's working yields, no? This loss energy that we are measuring. Here in EDS, the process is slightly different. We have always our electron that is going through the materials, through the atoms of this solid or material, whatever. And in this case, we are exciting one of these atoms, so one will be a transition between one electron from a state to another one, and in the excitation of this transition, it will emit X-ray, and this X-ray that we will measure. And here we see the comparison between two spectra, one EDS and another EELS, coming from the same material, nickel oxide. And you will see exactly the difference between the two techniques. We can see already that, okay, the elemental one is provided by the two of them. We know that we have oxygen and we have nickel. But we see also in the EELS that they are the differences are very high, very, very important, because we see all this fluctuation in the signal, that all this different behavior of the signal, that is the richness of this technique. And we will describe what is happening there. Here in this table, we can compare the two techniques. As I told you before, in both of them, you can do elemental identification. You can know what are the different material, the different elements in your material. In the EDS, at the beginning was very slow, the collection of the data. In EELS, it's much faster, it's even below a second, much now even microseconds. And in this case, you will see that it's changing also. In EDS, it's very good for the detecting heavy atoms. In EELS, you can detect everything, but okay, the lighter are the best, or not, depends of the material, but it's detecting very well all the boron, carbon, nitrogen, and so on. The resolution is around 100 EVs in EDS. In the case of EELS, we have now even few milli electron volts of resolution. That, we can see that here already. One is these peaks that they are so broad, are related with the resolution of the technique and the processes that are behind. The good point for EDS that is very easy, is almost a press button technique. And it's a little bit more complicated, but I hope that today I will show you that there is not a technique so complicated once you know what or how to process and how to behave in front of the microscope. But as I told you, things changed, and since 2009, 2010, so 6, 7 years ago, 5, 6 years ago, there was a boom that is still now with the improving of the signal, with the new detectors that they are coming to the market, and they were developed at these different places several years ago. And in this case, they could collect very good EDS signal, very fast, and even at atomic resolution, as you can see here. And it's interesting to compare the two techniques. And tomorrow I will give you a real example of this kind of analysis, in more or less in the same material, in a perovskite. So you see here that the both of them are very reasonable in terms of the sampling or even the speed of the acquisition. And now this table that I showed you before, we can start to change things.
Now I know how to change it from 4:3 by 16. Design.
Okay. Sorry.
Yeah. 16 by 9. No, the other one. Maybe it works. Okay.
Maximizar, no?
Yeah. If it doesn't work, your output.
Okay.
No, try this one.
Ah, okay.
If it doesn't work, because maybe try to adjust the switch. You know.
Now it's
you need to put them on this.
Yes, I try.
Let's see if it works.
Okay. Well, okay. Let's continue. Sorry, really sorry about all the these interruptions. And, okay, so the table now is completely different, as I mentioned before, and in terms of time are very similar, but the things that they are not changing and they won't change is the resolution and so on. So now it's interesting to see the comparison between both of them, and as I told you, tomorrow you will see a very good example where they are doing quantification, but it's something that is always good to know. So we continue with our technique, that is ILS, and an important point here is to see the geometry of the
it's
continue doing this stuff.
If you have an output, then you need output.
No, it's out of the bus. To be honest, I never had a problem with this one. I can understand if you have a Mac or something like that, that is a PC. So I don't know why we have this. But this considering this one that is the second computer. No, pero... This is the only way because it's recognizing the other one. Like Carlos, todo estaba trabajando. Todo. Yo creo que ha sido porque hemos estado tocando cosas para ajustar y el que va mal es el proyector ahora. No es el ordenador.
Doesn't change for just project the direction without that model. Yeah, it's there.
Okay. Sorry. Let's hope the best and that it works. I hope. Okay, so let's see the ILS geometry of the experiment. No, it's not working. Four by three.
Design.
No, I did. But it's running. Yo no sé. It's completely lost now.
Ah, let me see.
No, wait a minute, because it's something, I don't know why we have four of...
Is there a hope? No.
No, now the Microsoft stopped it. Okay. I think so. Should be okay now. We changed too many things to adapt and not. Sí. Vamos a intentar en este, si no sí, si no hay ningún problema. Pero en principio es que yo creo que no es el ordenador. Hemos estado jugando con todo, con el proyector y yo creo que es. No es. Now it's perfect, even in the terms of the resolution and so on. Okay, so we start from the beginning. Okay, so we continue with the geometry of the experiment. So we have our wave plane there with our electron that is coming through your sample, and there you have two parameters that they are very important. One is this angle here, the scatter angle, and the second one is the loss energy that we are detecting here in the detector, okay? So the scatter angle here, if we see here this sketch there, this little design there, we know that it's related with the momentum transfer, no? The transfer momentum that is something similar to the optics, okay? And we know that this modulus of this transfer momentum can be wrote in this, under this expression, okay, where you have K, that is the initial one, the momentum in this the original from the for the electron, and you have this one that is after the scatter. We can see that always this scatter angle is below one radian in this in our experiments, and in this case, this expression could be wrote in this expression. And there we have a very new important parameter that is the characteristic angle, no? That is the most probable angle for an scatter suffering for an element. Can be wrote in this way, where we have delta E, that is the loss that we are measuring. And it means that is with this gamma here is the relativistic term, so that is for electrons above 100 kilo electron volts. If not, we can do an approximation, and is this characteristic angle is 2 times the loss energy divided by the energy of the electrons, the kinematic energy of the electrons. So the question here is how we measure these two parameters, theta or transfer momentum, and delta E, the loss energy. And we can see here that more or less the numbers behind these two parameters. No? For let's say for the phonons or the plasmons, for instance, we are dealing with something that is few EVs to 30 EVs, even 40 EVs. For interband or intraband transition is something between 2 and 20 EVs. We have the phonons that we can measure now also in EELs with this range of energies, and all the absorption edges at this energy. Here we have several examples for the characteristic angle, comparing with the for different materials at 200 kilo electron volts, and we see more or less the values that we can get. It's a, as I told you before, it's a very very important parameter. It's something that you need to keep in mind, and you will see the implication of this parameter when you are doing an experiment. Okay, so the question was how to measure both of these parameters, and we know that there are the possibility to do EELs, not in a microscope, but in another kind of instrument, and in this case we call that high resolution EELs or reflectivity EELs, EELs in reflection, That is a momentum resolve technique, and there are several places over the world to do this kind of experiment. I know this one of Dresden, that is still running. And there, as I already mentioned, no, they have very good momentum resolution. But we know this Heisenberg principle. It means that if we know very well the momentum, we don't have any spatial resolution. So if we compare this technique with our TM, of course, they have very good momentum resolution, but the spatial resolution is not so good like in our case. They can go lower, but in this case, they are losing resolution of momentum. In terms of energy resolution, more or less nowadays with our monochromators, we are more or less in the same at the same level. And if we take care of or we consider the TM, we know that we have the possibility also to have more or less good momentum resolution. Or if we prefer, we can have very good spatial resolution, atomic resolution. In this case, the momentum is completely lost, the resolution at the momentum is is completely lost. And here we have an example. No? Now you know very well that we can have a zero here, 0.00 in terms of resolution, so add here another term in terms of momentum. And another important point, comparing both of them, is the signal to noise ratio. They have very good one because they have the possibility to average in the sample. Okay. Let's go now to see what are the instruments that we have to do ILS and what are the different two techniques that can be related with ILS. Yes.
Okay. That means you are saying something like this when you show momentum and momentum. If the core loss high amount of the energy, can I get easier atomic resolution compared with the loss fuel energy? I'm saying that, for example, for cobalt, and I guess it's possible to get easier atomic resolution. I'm just saying in terms of quantum momentum. Then carbon, for example. This equation means this.
No. Because there the differences are very, very low. There is an influence there, but it's not. We cannot consider this kind of effect like that. There are other effects related with kinematical issues. At some point, yes, but.
You did some relation between transfer momentum and the resolution.
Yes.
For low.
Yes.
For high transfer momentum, the resolution will be lower.
Yes. Yes. But after you are considering
momentum, the energy is this low and high.
Yes, and there are some tables there are some tables where you can see this kind of issues, but the difference is very low. It's nothing that is. Really important to consider,
okay.
But the difference are low. Okay, so that is a very good point. If you want to stop me and to come, I can come back to explain something to go more in detail. Don't be afraid. You can always ask. Yes. So that is here more or less the historical point of view, how the evolution of the ILS technique, so it started more than 70 years ago. That is the first example of an ILS spectrum. They were several groups working on this area, very low, only few groups over the world doing this kind of experiment. I think the most advantage, the biggest step was here in 62 in Paris by Henry and Castan, that they did this double magnetic prism, and they could get better spectra. And other important improvements are coming here with the work of Ross and with some collaborators there in the 70s, 90s. And again, something that was very, very important was this improvement done by this company, by Gatan, with this Pils spectrometer in 86 with the 666 that is still working in several places, more or less some modifications, but still being the same spectrometer, and with the rest of the family that is coming in 2000, 2003, 2007, like the quantum right now, and so on. And we will see what are the differences between these omega filters that we are seeing here, coming from these works, original works, the seminal works of Ross, and with the GIF and these instruments there. So, in any case, we have here a cartoon or an image, how is working this process. We have this picture because it's so saying something about how is this spectrometer. It's like a magnetic prism, so it's similar to the optical prism. We have, in our case, we have white light, in this case, white energy, range of energy coming from the electrons, and we are going to a magnetic sector, and we are dispersing the energy of these electrons, so it's really the same like in the photons. And we have here the sketch, what is happening. We have our object here. We have this plane that is conjugated, the dispersion plane. And for different energies of the electrons, the different loss energy that is related with the atoms, with the elements, you will see that the image in the dispersion dispersive plane are at different heights because the Lorentz force is acting there, and see if you have an electron that is losing a lot of energy or with a high energy, will suffer less the Lorentz force, and if the energy is lower, is more deflected and will be there. Seeing this image, you can also have the idea that we can have here like an optical system, a lens, and that is the principle of the GIF. Here we have the second step. We have again our object. We have this conjugated plane here, the dispersive plane. If we put there a slit, yeah, we are collecting electrons with that they lost a particular energy, and they will be forming an image here that is conjugated to the O prima, that is your phosphorus screen. And we see that we can form really an image in this case. And this image that we are forming is formed with the electrons that they lost this particular energy, as I told you. For instance, if we have carbon, we were discussing about carbon, so in our material there, we are forming the image of the carbon distribution in this plane. So that is the principle of the STEM, the energy filter transmission electron microscope. Here we have the two kind of magnetic prism or magnetic spectrometers. No? One that is post-column, that is more or less this one that you are seeing everywhere, that is coming from GIF, from Gatan, the GIFs. And we have another one that is the omega filter on the mandolin or whatever, that is this filter here with this magnetic prism over there. But the principle is the same. you are deflecting the electrons for different energies. This one, now there is only one company, Geol, that is doing that, using this kind of filters, and not too much, because the rest is under the monopoly of the GIFs. You see that the GIF evaluated is not only this magnetic prism. We have several lenses here, quadrupoles and sextuples, in order to correct the aberrations. So it's an optical system, so they have aberrations, and they can be corrected in order to get better resolution, always to have this kind of resolution. So here is the GIF, several models of the GIF, the original one, the 666. After you saw the 766, the 2000, now we are in the 966, that is the quantum. We have here the cartoon or the sketch of the tritium with all these magnetic elements to have better, as I told you, better resolution, so correcting all the aberrations. And okay, so the thing that we are measuring in ILS is an object that we call data cube. It's a 3D object that is in two directions, x and y, the spatial coordinates, and the third one will be the energy, the loss energy. That is why we have a 3D object. And we have two different ways to build this object. One will be rastering the beam and collecting for each proposition a whole is spectrum, that is a spectrum imaging. Could be a spectrum line if you are doing only one dimension, a line. But the other one is the, as I told you before, the FTEM, the energy filter. In this case, is in this direction. You are cutting the data cube in this direction, and you can, at the end, you have the same information. You are building this object, whatever you want, FTEM or ILS. You will see the difference between both of them. And let's start with FTEM. FTEM, of course, could be an image, could be also diffracted. You can also filter the electrons after the diffraction. That is the way that we are working on in FTEM. I don't know why we have these strange things, but we have this one that is called jump ratio, and the other one, the three windows. Remember that we had this spectrum, ILS spectrum, no? The total one and the core losses. So we have a strong background that is coming from the low losses, from the plasmons, this contribution there. And we need to subtract, eliminate this background in order to have the signal, the characteristic signal of our material. So we are choosing these two windows before or below the edge to model, to have a model of the background after we are subtracting them and getting only the signal. In this one, we have only one window that is below the signal, and the process is the same. And that is the way that we are choosing that in the digital micrograph, that is the software that is running the GIFs and all the spectrometers, even the omega filters are running by digital micrograph. Okay. That is an illustrative example that what can be done in FTEM. This is from the old works of Julie Capillet in Paris, in the Onera. That was 17 years ago during her PhD. And in this case, you have here a nanoparticle with several nanotubes, and she was interested in to know what was the growth mechanism of single wall carbon nanotubes. And you know that you need nanoparticles, catalytic particles, that they are playing an important role in the growth. And you need to know really what is the chemistry of these nanoparticles, and the most important one at the surface of the nanoparticle. So at the beginning, she was doing her resolution TM. she couldn't solve, she couldn't get any chemical information about the material. So the idea was, okay, let's try to do FTEM to see if we can get this information. So she was doing this kind of experiments. The nanoparticles were the nickel and cerium. And you have here the way that she was working. She chose two windows before the edge of the nickel. The same for the cerium. Okay, and you can have the elemental map of nickel. And the same for the cerium. And she could get this information and see that at the surface of the nanoparticles, you can have some cerium that is also playing an important role in the growth of the nanotubes. This example is coming from also all works, but from me, that I was doing in superconductors. And here is only to illustrate that in some cases you have the edges that they are overlapping, and the only way to avoid this lack of information is considering both of them. And okay, you can see more or less the chemical information that you can get in these nanoparticles that were inserted in the YBCO material. As I told you before, we can also do FTEM, but for diffraction. And you see here a very nice example, the information, the way that how can be done and the information that you can get. When this morning you saw seabed, I suppose you were doing, you had a lecture in diffraction, so for sure was based in seabed. So here you see the information that you can get when you are filtering these diffraction patterns. That is filtering for the cellulose, and you have after the contribution of the different plasmas that they are blurring a little bit the images. And that is a clear example how the information can be much improved if you are filtering and only collecting the elastic part, so the cellulose. You see that it's the same material, the same place, everything is the same. The only thing is that you are filtering these electrons and the information is clear. Okay, now let's go to the second technique, the STEM yields, and for me is probably the most appropriate for most of the studies. And as I told you before, we are building the data cube in a different way because we are rastering the bin and collecting the whole yield spectrum. No? That was developed several years ago, almost 30 years ago, in Auxerre by the group of Christian colleagues. And okay, it has been also used in all these different techniques, not only in yields, cathode luminescence, and spectrum imaging. And that is the way that is working. We have a nanoparticle, and we are collecting the different spectra here, you see. And after, we are doing filtering all these signals to get the elemental maps, in this case, iron and oxygen, because it was an iron oxide nanoparticle. We will see several examples to illustrate that. That is the same, but in the case of a spectrum line, that was a single wall boronite nanotube, and we can see the boron KH and the nitrogen KH. And we can see how is the distribution in this direction. We are approaching, going through the nanotube, and we see after we can get all the information that is provided by yields. The information are three kind of information that you can get from yields. That is one of the spectra, one of those collected in this area. So I told you there are three kind of information. The first one, the elemental one, identification. We know that we have boron and we know that we have nitrogen. The second one, we can do the quantification. But we will see later the limitation of this technique. And we can see that, okay, the stoichiometry is the good one. Boron and nitrogen, one. So it's perfect. And the third one, we can see the illness, this fine structure near of the edges. And we can see that we are dealing with a material that is a sp2, because we have the contribution of this pi star peaks, so these pz orbitals. And also we can describe a little bit later, we will see later, what is the kind of information. So you see the richness of this technique is that is providing a lot of information, even electronic information. So, I wanted to show you several examples that we can do. This is a sample containing nanotubes and nanoparticles. And here I was interested to know what was the chemical information that we can get about these nanoparticles. For several reasons, not only because are part of the sample, so they are contributing to the macroscopic response of the material, but also because can have an information about the growth mechanism of the nanotubes. That is always something that you need to keep in mind. No? So if you are doing a spectrum image, we have here an agglomerate of nanoparticles. You are collecting this spectrum image, so rastering the beam, collecting all this spectrum, and that is the total one. I am adding all the spectra that I collected there. And we can see that we have several edges, the boron KH, the carbon KH, L2-3 of calcium, nitrogen KH, and the oxygen. So now we can plot the different elements there. We can see the distribution of the boron, carbon, calcium, nitrogen, and oxygen. So, okay, now we know the configuration of these nanoparticles. But we see that there are some relations between different materials, like boron and oxygen, different elements, boron and nitrogen, and so on. So the question, and we will see later, is it possible to go further and to analyze that with better detail about the different elements, the different materials that they are composing these nanoparticles? The answer is yes, but it will be, now is more standard. Several years ago was a challenging experiment. Okay, so if now we compare the two techniques, the FTEM and the STEM, we can see the advantage and the limitation of each of them. Let's see, probably the easiest way to compare both is the FTEM is providing higher for the materials, no, for samples that they are lower in magnification. You can collect data for bigger areas, probably reducing the dose. So it's a technique that is very useful in bio. Tomorrow I will show you several examples of bio doing FTEM. But in terms of STEM, okay, you can get probably now is faster. The beginning was not the case, but now it's faster. And you can play with also with the dose and so on. Let's see, I think in terms of energy, in terms of spatial resolution, it's a little bit better. No, a little bit better, no, it's better STEM than FTEM. Even if the technique, remember, the information is the same. It's the data cube that we are collecting. It's the way that we are collecting this data cube. So an important point in any analytical technique, is the quantification. No? To know if we can get information about the putting numbers to this kind of analysis. So here we have a spectrum and the way that we are proceeding, analyzing it. Is carbon KH. So as I told you before, we are, the first thing is to subtract the background, ¿vale? Okay. And after we have this signal that is coming only from this kind of the signal that we want to analyze. We are modelizing that is the contribution here, this signal with some expressions. In this case will be a Hartree Slater cross section that will be simulated. And okay, it's more or less the how we are proceeding now for the next step, that will be the quantification. There are two aspects that we need to consider. One is the thickness of the sample, and the second one is the aperture, the collection angle that we are using. And we will see the influence of these two parameters. So the only point here is when we are doing quantification in yields, it's not an absolute way to do. We need to do that in relative way. Why? Because if you know, you see this expression here, we know that this signal that we are collecting, this in this case the blue one here after this simulation and so on, is proportional to the intensity, the initial intensity of the electrons, proportional to the number of atoms, so the number that we want, and the sigma that is this cross section that I told you before. The only point is this sigma we can modelize and we can get this information. That is the number that we want to have. And this signal is this one that we are collecting. So the only point that we don't know is this initial intensity. So in this case, that is why it's relative, because if you are doing the relation between two elements, the boron and nitrogen, you can read out of this intensity, initial intensity, and you can have the composition analysis of the quantification, so the relationship between the two elements there. And that is the way that we are proceeding. But I told you that there are some limitations, some drawbacks. One, that they are relating with the signal-to-noise ratio and signal-to-background ratio, that they are always depending of these two parameters that I told you before, the thickness and the collection angle. Let's say it's a technique that we can get more or less a precision around 10-15%. So don't trust always the results that you are getting in yields. Tomorrow I told you that we will see an example where you can trust, but you need to do that in a very, very proper way. But okay, you can have an estimation. 10% of error is not so bad. Knowing that it's something local, you are even the in some cases the precision is much better, because if you are doing atomic resolution, it's a thin sample, as we will say later. We'll see several examples that there is an atomic layer of graphene. So there, what is the quantification? Doesn't matter. You have only one atom there, so it's perfect. But they are only particular conditions. No? And two other things that we need always to consider is the contamination and the damage. And that is a little bit of nightmare in TN. And particularly in yields.
So, how much do you think about quantification when, in the same way, when I need different edges, K is ML?
Supposing that you are collecting for the same element, different edges?
No, no, I'm saying, for example, if I collect silicon.
Ah.
And,
yes. Yes, you are right. Yes, that is a good point, because I told you that we are simulating here the cross section, and okay, you are using Hartree Slater or hydrogenoid expressions or simulation. Sorry. So for sure, there are some variations or the way to simulate that. But if you can do that also very properly, in a proper, very proper way, and, but of course, yes, will be better for instance, a carbon KH to simulate that, another M or N H probably that is a little bit more complicated. But it, of course, yes, it's playing an important role. Okay, that is the detection and quantification limit. We are reading something in yields between 1 EVs to 2,000 EVs, and it's working very well for the light atoms, like I just mentioned, but we have some problems in some heavy atoms, but okay. And in the light atoms, like sulfur of phosphorus, okay, depends also in this case the signal to background that could be also a little bit difficult. So, okay, how is working? It's working in terms of, I told you that there is a limitation, that is the thickness. And because we want to have always a single event, single inelastic event, very thin samples. But we know very well in TM, it's very, very difficult to have a sample that is lower than 30 nanometers. Usually you have something that is 60, 70 nanometers thick. So there, this single event is not possible because you have your electron and it's interacting with the atoms of your material and you have plenty of events, or inelastic events. So these ones are contributing to the plasmons and you have a lot of background and it's much difficult. But there is a way to avoid this or to at least limit this kind of situation. And it's this kind of the convolution. Suppose that always we have a Poisson distribution. And we know this Beer's law, Beer-Lambert law, that is telling us about the absorption of any process. We saw that in tomography late before. It's always the same expression. And in this case, it's related with this exponential part where we have T, that is the thickness of your material, and lambda, that is the mean free path of the electrons. So what is the probability, or what, no, sorry, what is the distance between two different inelastic scatters, inelastic events? What is the distance that the electrons are doing before doing a second inelastic event? And we know this expression for calculating this lambda. And the way to proceed is, okay, we have the incident intensity here. We have this one that is coming from the plasmons, and this is the expression. We can calculate that. You see here in this example how the importance of the things that I just mentioned is. Here we have the plasmon, and when it's thick, very thick, when the T over lambda, that is the parameter that you need to always to keep in mind, is very high, is even above a value of one, you have this multi-plasmon resonance there. And okay, that is, it means that you have a very thick sample. Always try to have something that is around 0.2, but is the ideal case, and it's always too complicated. But below 0.3, 0.4 is something that you can trust in terms of quantification. And we will see here the effects of this quantification. You see here for this ratio of number of atoms, when this T over lambda is going a value of one, you see that you cannot trust anymore this quantification, or you have more incertitude about the quantification. And here you see the example. You have the low losses for the same iron oxide for different T over lambda, and you see that for high T over lambda values, the information is the signal to ground is much lower, and you see in the low losses that you have more contribution of the plasma. So again, avoid thick areas in order to do a proper quantification. But if you cannot avoid, suppose that is more or less always the case, you have another possibility to analyze the data, and that is this using this deconvolution, the Fourier ratio deconvolution. In this case, you need to collect the both spectra, the low loss and the core loss. And here I am showing you an spectrum, an example that I was collecting in a narrow diamond film that was thick. And as I told you before, I want to have always the signal for a single event. I cannot get this single event process, but I can do this deconvolution that is saying that this Fourier transform of a single event is equal to the Fourier transform, the Fourier transform of the zero loss multiplied by the Fourier transform of the element that the signal that we are doing here, analyzing here, and this one of the plasma. Okay, if we are doing this formula using this this deconvolution that is automatically done in the digital micrograph, we can get this kind of signal, the Greek one, and you see that the information is much easier to analyze. Okay, continuing this kind of things that you need to keep in mind, the second one, the second parameter that I told you before, is the collection angle. And the collection angle is also playing an important role, as you can see here, for different elements, for different, the same voltage, at 200 kilo electron volts, and you see how is the collection angle is acting in terms of the quantification. No? So if you are taking a 10 milliradian collection angle, you will see that it depends on the, for instance, if you are collecting for the carbon, okay, you are getting something like 80% of the signal, so it's very good. But if you are here for the titanium, KH is very poor. So it's something that you need to have also in mind. It's not always easy to do that. When you are doing that in the TM, the first thing is I am collecting the data. But okay, we can trust after the data that you are collecting. So keep these things in mind. These tables are very illustrative. So take it. And you see here a real example, silicon carbide. Silicon carbide, the stoichiometry is 1 by 1. And if I am choosing the wrong collection angle, a very low one, I can have a 20% of error in the quantification, 20%. Okay, okay, that is in the case of overlapping edges, but okay, it's something also that is difficult to analyze, to get the quantification, because everything is together. But, so it's difficult to substrate the background properly and so on, but it's a detail. But okay, I mentioned before that now we have atomic resolution, and the first example, probably showing this atomic resolution, that was not an aberration corrected microscope, was the work of Kazuo Enaga 16 years ago in this kind of material that was an ideal one. We have pivots, it means we have nanotubes. Inside these nanotubes, you have another molecule that is a fullerene, and this fullerene was doped with this gallium, and he could detect the gallium atoms in this material. So that is showing the powerful of the technique, the power of the technique. And the second important point that the information that we can have in yields is this analysis, this Ernest analysis, the fine structure near of the edge. Here, I don't know, probably I am out of time, no, already. Or 10 minutes? 50 minutes, okay, so I don't know the numbers of, I will be a little bit run. I will run a little bit. Okay, so Ernest is this fine structure near of the edge, this fluctuation that we are seeing here in the signal. We have another region that we are not discussing too much, that is the X-selves, that they are the extended fine structure. Not many people, only reduced number of people are working on this region. So I am not talking, even if the information is very rich, it's very complicated to have. And I have here an example, probably. Yes, we have this titanium diboride. You have the crystalline and amorphous faces. And with this X-selves analysis, they can get something that you can be interested because you can get also the low rich order and so on. But it's, again, it's difficult to analyze. Eh? And you can distinguish between these configurations, the different configurations. But something that everyone is interested in is the fine structure near of the edge, so the illness. And I am coming back to the expression that we got before. And we have here these two terms, one that is related with the transition probability between the different states, the transitions that we are seeing, and the energy, of the conservation of energy. In this case, we can see that this double differential cross section that we are measuring in yields is proportional to this magnitude, can be seen like two terms, one that is related with the probability of these transitions, and the other one, the rho e, that is the density of states. It's a local density of states because we are analyzing core states that they are very localized. Okay? And that it means that in the case of the boron nitride, hexagonal boron nitride, we can see the difference between the boron and the nitrogen KH. The presence of the exciton in the boron KH that is related with the density of states of the boron. Okay, so let's see another very illustrative example about the richness of this illness. We have boron, the elemental boron, in different states, pure boron, boron oxide, boron boric acid, boron carbide, cubic boron nitride, and hexagonal boron nitride. And you see that the spectrum are completely different. The only one that they are the same is boron oxide and boric acid, because the difference between these two elements in terms of yields is that we have a molecule of water there. But the signal is, the yield signal is the same. But the rest are completely different. And that is the richness of the yields, and the illness in particular, because you can have all this information. And we will see several examples of that. And that is one of those, the carbon. We have several allotropes of carbon. We have diamond, we have graphene, we have nanotubes, we have fullerenes, we have, and everything can be distinguished only analyzing in yields. And the clear example is the difference between graphite and diamond, because the diamond is an sp3 material comparing with the graphite, that is an sp2. And in this case, you have the presence of the pi star peak in the graphite. And okay, it's very easy having the same element but different material to distinguish the two of them, and even the amorphous carbon that is, this spectrum is very well, you will recognize very easy because contamination and so on is related with the presence of this carbon. And the second example is the boron nitride, and we have the boron and the nitrogen KHs. And again, we can also prove the anisotropy, in terms of the structure, but also that is related with the electronic anisotropy of the material. And in terms of how you are proving the material, you can have an enhancement or vanishment of the of the different of the pi star contribution, because these are the 2pz orbitals that you are proving, and the orientation of these orbitals of this material and these orbitals against the electron beam is enhancing the signal or not. And the next example is coming back to the original one. Remember that we have this agglomerate of nanoparticles, and I told you that it's very hard to, we could know the different spectra, the different composition of the material, but I mentioned already that it was a difficult material. In only in few nanometers, and all these nanoparticles are based on boron, and we can see that at different places, at different spots, the signal is completely different. And we have four spectra here that can be recognized like reference, coming from boron, pure boron, boron oxide, and hexagonal BN for the two different orientations. And you have here the combination of these different signals. So the question here is, as I mentioned at the beginning, no? Is possible to go further to the analytical, to the elemental technique, and to recognize where is the boron, the oxygen, the calcium, and so on? Yes, it's possible to do this kind of analysis. This is the MLS or NNLS fit, so it's a statistical analysis. It's a multiple least square fit, and in this case, we have that the signal that we are collecting is equal to the combination of linear combination of these different signals of each of these elements of these materials, so boron oxide, boron nitride, pure boron, and this linear coefficients that we are seeing here is the weight of each of these materials present in the sample. So let's see, A, B, C, D, and so on, will give us the map of the distribution of each of these materials. That is the way that we are proceeding. And in this case, the result is the following. Is, of course, we can get this very useful information about the distribution. In this case, not only the distribution of the element, but also the bonding chemical analysis. And to know that inside of these nanoparticles you have a pure boron nanoparticle that is covered by boron oxide, and everything is covered by boron nitride. And right now we are going further in the analysis, but will be in the near future. Something that it will be very, very nice with this kind of analysis. And okay, that is the kind of fit that you can get, and the kind of accuracy that you can get. Let's continue. Okay, that is a good example also from this example. The influence of the thickness. You see that regarding the window that you are considering for this fit that I mentioned before, you can, if you consider a small window, 18 EVs, everything goes more or less perfect. That is the key square, so the quality of the fit. But when you are considering 32 EVs, that you have the contribution of the plasma there, you have all these thickness effects. So again, the analysis should be done always in a proper way. So aspects to consider that I told you before: collection angle, thickness, and background. And here we are dealing with a very nice example of graphite and how the influence of the collection angle can you are in the same area. The only thing that you are changing is the collection angle. And you see that the signal that you are collecting is completely different. The question is how you can change the collection angle. There are only two ways. One is changing the camera length if you are in STEM, and the second one is changing the aperture of the spectrometer. So again, you need always to consider this value. And this value, if you are doing quantification, remember, is will be two or three times the characteristic angle of your element. And now we will see two different examples, two different kind of examples that we can do in ILS. One will be momentum resolve, and the other one, spatial resolution. Let's start with the momentum resolve, because I told you right at the beginning that we can do this kind of experiments. And this is a fair example. We are coming back to the boron nitride. And the idea here was it was possible to really prove at the maximum this anisotropy, this electronic anisotropy of this material, and to prove like they are doing X-rays. So the answer at the end was yes, but it was a little bit, was a very nice exercise. And in this case, okay, that is the way that we were doing this experiment. We have our boron nitride flake there, and we have only two possibilities. One is tilting. You need to have always a very small collection angle, collection aperture there, to define a very good momentum resolution. So in this case, you are losing the spatial resolution. Here we had something like that was around 1 micron resolution, so parallel beam, 1 micron illuminating the whole sample. And in this case, you have very good momentum resolution because you are choosing, as I told you before, a very small aperture, right? And collecting only with a particular Q momentum transfer. And I told you there are two ways to proceed. The first one will be to tilt the sample. And we have here the diffraction pattern, so going in this direction, collecting there or there or there. Eh? And the second one, the easiest one, okay, don't tilt the sample and move the aperture, like we are seeing here in the design. And in this case, you can get this kind of result, and you have the boron and nitrogen KH, and you are seeing how it's evolving in terms of the pi star that will be you are proving as I told you before, no, the sp2 material, so the pz orbitals, and you are not exciting. You are seeing or not seeing the interaction with the for boron and nitrogen. And these kind of things were done in the past also by Lehmann and Silkos. More than 30 years ago, in the case of graphite, that was also a very nice example. But okay, here the concept was the same, but you see that they couldn't get this very good momentum resolution, and in this case, they saw always the presence of the pi star. But doesn't matter; the concept is the same, and the experiment was very very good, very nice. And that is the things that I was telling you, the kind of analysis that of the pi orbital that you are proving there. And a second step that was under discussion at the beginning of this century was the presence of the magic angle, that is clear. And it was several groups were working on this topic, trying to have this magic angle, collection angle, that it means that if you are choosing these conditions, doesn't matter your orientation of the sample, that the result that you are getting is unreasonable. And this controversial point was solved 10 years ago by Cécile Bert, that she was doing this kind of analysis in different materials, and choosing the taking into account the relativistic effects and providing this magic angle for different elements. Other important experiments that now, since let's say 7 years, so a little bit of people are very excited is the possibility to do the circular dichroism, like in the X-rays. And it's coming, these words are coming from the same group that before, this one of in Austria, the group of Esas-Neisler in Vienna. And they were proving the possibility to have this information, this momentum resolve yields to have the information about the magnetic moments of the material. So like, yes, the chiral dichroism that they are doing in magnetism. And the information is very low. You see the difference between the two signals is very low. It's tricky to have the information, but it's possible under some particular cases. And more recently, the group of Joberbeck in Anvers developed this vortex technique in order to prove also this, to use for other many reasons and other applications, but one of the applications is to have this momentum resolve also, and to do this kind of analysis of the magnetic moments of this material. In this case, that was also doing spin polarized transitions in ferromagnetic materials. So, is as I told you, it's a field that is evolving, and people are involved, several groups, and it's interesting, it's a very nice approach. And the second kind of works are the spatial resolution, that they are probably the most, let's say, appear. This one that the people stay more excited by this kind of results. And I choose several examples. The first one is probably the first example of atomic resolution that is coming from the group of Penny Cook in Oak Ridge in Tennessee. Maria Varela was working on this group and collecting this kind of data and proving this atomic resolution in this perovskite. And okay, at the same time, there is another group that was developing more or less the same kind of analysis. So let's say, since 10 years ago, things changing too much, and that is due to the presence of the aberration-corrected microscope, but because that was done in one of the first aberration-corrected microscopes. And okay, now we have this kind of resolution. And for me, you saw already more or less what are the materials that I am interested in. One of those is carbon materials, or low seed, low number, atomic number materials. One of the most interesting was this one, the works coming from Casu Suenaga in 2009. If you remember that I told you before, remember the paper that I showed you, Science in 2000, was from the same guy in different instruments. But here was proving also the presence in a nanotube of with fullerenes of okay, these atoms there that he could also map and see the difference in valence, so the illness, proving the illness in this materials. From the same group, you can see also this very nice group, example. You have graphene there, and he could analyze these flakes and it's having this atomic resolution, and to see the different configuration of the carbon atoms when they are in the edge or where they are in the middle, and you see the fine structure of the carbon edge is very rich. You have these different peaks that they are appearing depending of the atomic configuration of this carbon. So without this atomic resolution technique, it's impossible to have this information. And once you have this information, you need to run some simulation to interpret what is happening. And we are always doing this kind of, we are more and more collaborating with theoreticians in order to get this information. Another example is coming from us. In this case, it's a nanotube of carbon comparing with graphene, is much harder, is harder to work on carbon nanotubes. And here we were interested in to localize, for, in this case it was for the first time, the dopant of, with atomic resolution of the dopant, in the presence of the dopant in the nanotube. For the image it's very hard. You can see that here that is a little bit brighter. We were filtering the images and I was doing some simulations to, in order to prove that from the image we can have some information already. But the clear and the real proof is EELS with this assistive EV and with the spatial resolution that we got. And there you can see the signal from the nitrogen KH coming only from few pixels over there in this region. We could analyze that and comparing with the, again with the theory, and to analyze this kind of spectra and to see what is happening there. That was a little bit amazing for us. But right now, I am 2 months ago, the same group that I told you before, the group of Suenaga, is doing the same of kind of analysis in the graphene sheet, where they have several configurations of nitrogen sitting there. You see that there are dynamical effects, moving the nitrogen is moving from a place to another. But the most important point for me, and that is for that this morning I was thinking, okay, I will show you this kind of result. If we compare the theory that we were using ourselves to interpret the same configuration, a nitrogen atom in a substitutional way, in a graphitic configuration of a carbon nanotube or a graphene. And in their case, they are doing the same. And they found difference in terms of theory and experimental ones. OK, in terms of the experiment, it's true that the signal-to-noise ratio in our case was worse than in their case. And we couldn't solve this one. But in terms of the theory, something surprising. So again, if I am putting this example, it's not only because it's a nice paper, it's a nanoletters, I think. Yes, it's a nanoletters, but not only that, it's because, okay, the theory and the experiments, we need to think really exactly what we are calculating and the information that we are getting. And with that, I finish, but I am finished with some remarks about the specimen and the spectrum collection. They are very easy to keep in mind. The first one, okay, try to have the thinner sample that you can have. And after, remember all the parameters that they are not too much. The characteristic angle and the angle collection and so on. In order to do a proper analysis, if you want to do a proper analysis after collecting the data, I hope that is the case. And okay, you need to also to think what is the kind of technique that you want to do, FTM, EELS, EELS STEM, I would say, and the kind of information that you can get, and the kind of things that can happen, displacements, damage, contamination, and so on. That is in terms of the spectra, but I am not going through these things, but that is probably the final conclusion, that is this one, that keep in mind these parameters, and at least before doing the experiment, that is sometimes is hard, think about the kind of information that you can and you want to have. And here is the list of several books. I recommend you the first one for sure, the Egerton, also the last one, no, the last one, sorry. The Williams and Carter is very good. The three others also, I like too much, the Penny Cook and the Reimer. So, okay, these are things that if you are interested, look at these books and the, and it's all. If you have questions, here for that.
Thank you, Arnaud.